Today, we're incredibly fortunate to have three mayors with us, from Dallas, from Dayton, and from New Orleans, to discuss what is happening in different parts of the country and the role that leaders of companies, big and small, can play in the path forward. Mayor Johnson, Mayor Whaley, and Mayor Cantrell, thank you so much for joining us this evening, and welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you for being here. I'm going to start and dive right in with a question to all three of you, and we'll go through, and Mayor Johnson, I'm going to start with you. I'd really appreciate getting your perspective on the following. What have people in your cities been experiencing in recent weeks, and what can be done, in your opinion, to help build a more equitable and just society? And so, Mayor Johnson, why don't we start with you?
Well, going back to around the end of February, early March, is when I started to be told that this virus was coming our way, known as the coronavirus or COVID-19, that we needed to start to begin making some decisions about how we wanted to proceed as a city to make sure that the virus didn't spread quickly, more quickly than our hospitals were able to accommodate cases. And so that set off a series of decisions, starting with whether or not to cancel our St. Patrick's Day parade, which is a big deal in Dallas. Believe it or not, we have the largest St. Patrick's Day parade in the Southwest, but that was sort of the first decision in a series of decisions that ultimately led to us closing our bars and restaurants, except for takeout and delivery, which then culminated finally in where most of the country ended up, which was in some form of lockdown. So, for the past several weeks, our city has been dealing with the reality of the economic impact of being on lockdown and being in a situation where you have some state and local leaders who have ideas about how quickly the economy should be reopening and how that should look, and different ideas in Austin, our state capital, about how that should look. And all the while, our folks have been just dealing with the loss of jobs, furloughs, pay cuts, and then, of course, the toll of the disease itself, health-wise, has been significant as well. And we are starting to see our cases actually in Dallas start to rise again after a period of what appeared to be flattening, and maybe we were going to be on the decline. So, if you go back several weeks, we started with the pandemic, and then in the middle of a pandemic, which caused me to issue the first disaster, local disaster in the history of the city that we're aware of, we had to declare a second one to deal with the protests surrounding the death of George Floyd. And so our city is contending with the challenges that situation has brought. And so, early on in the week, last week, we had some looting and some things that were not related to the protests themselves that were very unfortunate and that we hated to see. But by and large, our protests have been peaceful in Dallas. We had one incident on June 1st on one of our signature bridges that was also rather unfortunate, that involved peaceful protesters who were fired on with rubber bullets and tear gas. And that's a situation that we're looking into and investigating right now. But it's been a tough go of it for the past few weeks in our city. And, Dallas is a resilient city. It's a tough city. It's been through a lot throughout its history, and we're going to get through this too. But one of the main things I'm focusing on is our economic recovery and making sure that Dallas is prepared to come out of this, better than we went into it in time. We know that won't happen right away, and I'm sure the mayors on this call will speak to their goals are very similar, I'm sure, to make their cities better than they were when we went into it. But by and large, we are going to do everything we can to try to get our small businesses, which are going to be at the core of this recovery, up and running as soon as possible.
That's terrific. Appreciate those comments. And I know, that seems very familiar. But Mayor Whaley, why don't we go to you? How have things been, in your city, and some comments on just how we move forward, build a more just and equitable society?
Well, I appreciate being on with my great friends, Eric and LaToya. It's great to see you guys virtually and appreciate all the great leadership they provide, not only to their cities, but to mayors across the country. And I think what we're all witnessing in our communities, and now I think we've had the entire country has experienced, and the whole entire world has experienced the COVID pandemic, and what we're experiencing now in 100 and over 150 cities across the country is a real calling for change. And the disruption that's happened both with COVID and the call for real equity in our communities, legitimate equity in our communities, is very strong. And it's powerful, and it is exciting, frankly. I think there is, with any disruption like COVID for businesses, there's going to be changes that come on the other side. And certainly with this call to action that has been slowly brewing, you know, as a mayor, this is, I think, my seventh year, you know, we have been witnessing this city by city, at least since 2014 with Freddie Gray. And so to see it across all cities across the country and to see swift reforms coming from mayors across the country, too, I think it's pretty exciting. I think there is a challenge in this whole conversation, both with COVID and with the protests and the opportunity for us to really work on systemic racism, is that, and we've seen this in business too, right? And with technology, that change is happening so very quickly that it's almost, it's very difficult for the human mind to keep up with the pace of change. And so I think we're seeing a lot of that, and that is uncomfortable for folks is on how fast it is happening. But at the same time, I think being a mayor at this time, it definitely challenges your leadership skills, but it gives great opportunity to really work to lead in a community, your community, in a way you really want to see it too. So I'm, you know, while we're going through this, I think there's great opportunity on the other side.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Mayor Cantrell, I'd love to hear it too. I'd appreciate hearing your perspective. And I know I've heard you speak about both empathy and respect is very important. And so maybe you can give us a couple of comments, too, on this.
Well, first of all, you know, thank you for having me. And it's always good to be with my brother and sister mayor, as Nan pointed out, in her leadership with the U.S. Conference of Mayors. But, you know, as it relates, to our city experiencing the impact of COVID and even just the civil unrest, which we welcome 100%. As it relates to getting our city and this country to a more equitable distribution, you know, and also building wealth and opportunity, which is what we're supposed to be about. So in the city of New Orleans, you know, we were definitely a hot spot, not only in the state of Louisiana, but the United States of America regarding this COVID. It hit us hard. Initially, I was like my brother mayor there in Dallas, who moved very quickly with canceling large gatherings, parades that really started with our St. Patrick's Day parade and our Mardi Gras Indian Super Sunday, which is a big deal, you know, in our city. But we moved very swiftly, shutting things down. And since then, you know, we've had over 7,200 cases in terms of positives, and we've lost over 513 of our residents that make up a large population of the African-American community in New Orleans, and quite frankly, a large population of our culture bears who are the bedrock of this city and really culture as it relates to the United States. And so our folks with, you know, who were disproportionately impacted, we understood that those disparity gaps existed pre-COVID, and we were focusing on those issues pre-COVID, but it always comes to ahead, your most vulnerable population of people tend to be the ones who suffer the most when tragedy and disaster hit. So clearly, we know we need to remain focused on our gaps in terms of our people, meeting them where they are and providing them with the tools and resources so that they can come out of this better than they were before. And also, we're preparing our communities to be more resilient. So the next tragedy that comes, the next, you know, disaster that comes, because it's not a matter of if, it's when, that we're protecting our people in a way that they can sustain whatever, you know, tragedy that comes their way. You know, our residents are struggling, quite frankly, to pay their rent, to avoid evictions. I have over 79,000 of our residents now on unemployment insurance. And our small businesses, again, are the bedrock. They're struggling hard to regain, you know, their footing and even learning new behaviors as it relates to reopening in this pandemic. So we're moving into phase two on Saturday. But again, we're leveraging our local, state, and federal dollars and national partnerships, again, to give them the resources that they need. And just being more creative and innovative in that approach. Goldman Sachs has been front and center on this, the $50 million in partnership with Hope. We have been able to execute that on the ground with our folks. And so we're just looking, continuing to advocate for more federal support that we need, because quite frankly, our cities need to be made whole. And the revenue loss is something that is not being focused on right now.
Very, very well said. You know, Mayor Johnson, Mayor Cantrell was just talking about how these kinds of crises affect the most vulnerable communities. That's certainly true with healthcare. Can you talk about disparity in health outcomes and additional steps you think could be taken to help address this and improve this as we go forward?
Yeah, I'll try to be more brief this time. But I think that the question of disparity, as my good friend Mayor Cantrell pointed out, is always an issue in public policy making, because our vulnerable populations tend to be the same. It's our communities of color, it's our low-income residents, and anytime the society at large, you know, gets sick, you know, gets a sniffle, the Black community and the low-income community catches a cold, as they say. And so, you know, this is no different. We see data across the country that suggests that there are disparities with respect to, you know, who gets COVID, which is probably related to who's working on the front lines and some of our more vulnerable walks of life in terms of work. So, you know, our frontline workers, grocery store workers, folks who are dealing with folks, high volumes of people are disproportionately representing minority communities. And I think we're seeing higher infection rates. In Dallas, I can say that the infections appear to be disproportionately Latino. We're not seeing, however, necessarily what you see in some places with the deaths from COVID not reflecting our population or being disproportionately one group or the other. But we're certainly keeping our eye on this. And I've appointed a czar specifically to keep an eye on and look at disparity issues, because we don't want that to become an issue. But what we are aware of, and what NPR recently pointed out, was that we have not done a great job in the city of Dallas in making sure that testing is available around our city, and particularly where our vulnerable populations live. So we have been recently putting more resources into mobile testing and increasing the availability of testing in the areas where our vulnerable populations live. Because we want folks to get tested, we want folks who've been participating in protests, which weren't always appropriately socially distanced, if we're honest about that, and people weren't always wearing masks. We applaud the people who were participating in the protests, but we want to make sure that they are safe and that their families are safe. So we're encouraging them now. We've popped up another testing location specifically to accommodate some of those folks. But that's what we are trying to do to address disparity, to have testing be more universally available, and to make sure that we have someone, I have appointed a very talented medical doctor with a background in epidemiology and public health to keep an eye on this disparity issue to make sure it doesn't become a bigger problem. But by and large, generally, this is one of those deals like everything else where vulnerable populations get hit the hardest.
Yeah. Mayor Whaley, I know equality is something you've been especially focused on in Ohio for a long time. Low-income communities facing higher unemployment rates, higher concentrations, as Mayor Johnson said, of COVID, greater barriers to accessing economic relief that we talked about a little bit earlier. How have you been approaching some of these challenges as you think about Dayton?
Well, in a couple of ways. First, you know, we've been raising dollars locally to try to really help our small businesses out during this time that are mostly women or minority-owned businesses during COVID. And then, you know, long term, really doing investments like we do with 10,000 small businesses, really trying to build and scale that workforce of entrepreneurship, even creating a hub in our downtown for those small businesses to really collaborate and collide, you know, after post-COVID collisions. And we're really excited about that. But there's a big part of Mayor's work that is around advocacy. And so I'm really pleased with the work that both mayors across the state of Ohio have been able to do with Governor DeWine and Senator Brown, getting on calls regularly, both asking for dollars to make sure that we can take care of this post-recovery, because if we don't have federal dollars to really invest in that, it is going to be our communities of color and those low-income areas, which are a big part of my city, that will be hit the most. And so, you know, I think that that is a really key job that we're doing right now as mayors. In addition, you know, getting the stuff done on the ground, but also being the voice for our communities that, quite frankly, don't have a large enough voice in our federal government.
Mayor Johnson, how are you seeing companies in your community, both large and small, trying to step up, stand up during this difficult time?
Our business community, if you want to try to divide it into, you know, big and small, are both stepping up to the plate and doing things to try to help us get through this tough time. I'll say this first and foremost, I'm so grateful to Goldman Sachs for coming to Texas and partnering with the Lyft Fund to create a vehicle to help get much needed capital into the hands of some of our most vulnerable businesses. We took a page out of your playbook at the city and created a small business continuity fund using some of our CARES Act money and some of our other federal dollars, CDBG funds and others that were able to be bundled for this purpose, and came up with a $5 million fund of our own to help support some of our small businesses. And then our private sector, mostly our large companies that are members of our Chamber of Commerce, took a page out of our playbook, which we took out of your playbook, which was to stand up a private sector version of the same fund. So we've now triple levered the idea because now the private sector is raising a $5 million fund. And this is coming from their own pockets, this is not government money. This is actually larger companies coming together and saying, you know what? It doesn't do us any good if Dallas fails. And Dallas will fail if our small business enterprises fail. And so even though these aren't necessarily companies that are in our supply chain specifically, or that we have some specific direct benefit to derive from helping, it's the right thing to do. And it's good for the city in the long run. They have come forward and said, here's what we want to do. And this platform is about to be announced very soon in terms of how to match people together. They want a mentoring relationship. They want a meaningful relationship with these small businesses. And so big companies are going to, in essence, adopt smaller companies, lend them money in a forgivable loan, and help get them through this pandemic so that we all can move forward and succeed together, which I think is an amazing thing, amazing concept. And I have to give you guys some credit for kind of kickstarting that conversation here locally. But we are all working together. Private sector, government, nonprofits are all working together to try to get capital in the hands of our small businesses, because we're afraid some of them are just not going to make it through this period if we don't give them that support. So that they're both working together to help move our city forward.
That's really great to hear. And obviously, it's great to see that playbook working that way. And, you know, the more I think we can see that, the public sector, the private sector, cities working together, you know, the more progress we're going to make. Mayor Cantrell, one of the things I've been telling people here at Goldman Sachs as we've been going through some of the things we've gone through the last couple of weeks is how important it is for all of us to listen, how important it is for all of us to engage in conversations that take us outside our comfort zone. Can you tell us about some of the conversations you've been having with members of your community in New Orleans, with other mayors? Any learnings around how we can all advance conversations and listen better on these important topics?
Well, you know, we have been having so many conversations. It's like an onion, you know, on multiple different layers, or, you know, whether it's, of course, with COVID and responding to that, to the racial inequities, you know, that are present, to the civil unrest that we're experiencing, and embracing that and embracing the change that I believe will come from it. So it's an exciting time. You know, I look at things, the glass, you know, half full, you know, and if it's coming, embrace that challenge. This is our time. This is our revolution, the revolution of our time. And so just encouraging conversations, getting outside of the bubble. Everybody's in one and in a different bubble, but you have to step outside of your bubble to be able to listen, to be able to appreciate and learn the experiences of other folks, to have a better understanding of why they feel the way they feel, why they think the way they do, why they do what they do. But it comes with getting outside that bubble first, with a willingness to embrace other people. And so setting that tone has been very important. We had a conversation about that I believe at the beginning of the week, opening up a town hall. I had another one again. We had one last week, one this week, as it relates to race and the disparities as well. And also just in terms of mayors, working with, you know, my colleagues across the country, sharing best practices, understanding that, encouraging one another that it is time to be bold, you know, no time for your head down. Let's step up and step out there, and making sure while we're putting a different face covering on, pulling those other ones off, you know, at the same time. So it's a collective effort. Also in regards to working with various mayors, you know, I've joined the Mayor's COVID-19 Recovery Task Force. There's only two mayors from the U.S. a part of it. It's a global leadership, and it's looking at ways to where we can pivot to be more resilient during this time, taking advantage of those opportunities. As Nan said, you have to be flexible, right? I mean, it really fluid, because flexible is still too rigid around here. So you have to be able to move swiftly, and keep it going. But this is the opportunity, even as it relates to New Orleans. And you know we're a destination city. You know, I have more than just Bourbon Street, but this is our time to re-envision, you know, and imagine the French Quarter, for example, making it more pedestrian friendly, doing no cars in the quarter, creating more pedestrian malls for social distancing, being more creative to where the businesses can operate with limited capacity. But they see again how government is trying to help them out to expand their business so that, again, they can make the resources that they need to employ our residents and to continue to operate as small businesses. So it takes all of us. And I think that's what the people are telling us. The people are on the streets for a reason. And it's also for us to listen. So I'm excited.
With that, it looks like we're out of time. I want to thank all three of the mayors, Mayor Johnson, Mayor Whaley, and Mayor Cantrell, for joining us this evening.